Peace party people. Once again, ladies and gentlemen, this is Let the Record Show. I am Mike Pizzo.
I'm Warren Peace.
And today's special guest is...
RJD2.
RJD2, welcome,
yes.
Man.
Yes.
Yes.
Thanks for having me.
Yes, and I will also add that you are talking to the webmasters of RJD2site.com, your old...
We go way back, man.
We go way back.
We go back to the days of taking boxes of CDs to the post office.
100%.
And shipping them out, you know,
yes.
Whatever, 30, 60, 90 at a time.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, man.
It's fucking great days, man.
It was
Do you miss them?
Yeah, I do. No, I do. I do. I actually, what I don't miss are doing returns to Caroline Distribution like once a month and staying, you know, seeing like the evidence of your failures. Like, oh, I ordered like 60 copies of Anti-Pop Consortium and it didn't move and now I have to send them all back.
Yeah. Yeah, I can imagine.
Right. So you gave us a list of some of your favorite tracks of all time, and then we hunted down everything on vinyl, and now we're going to play those tracks and let the record show.
Sounds great. Let's do it.
All right. Let's do it. All right. First up, RJ, we have A Tribe Called Quest, Midnight Marauders, and man, this is just one of the greatest albums of all time. I think everybody here is probably incredibly influenced by this record.
Amazing.
And yeah, it's just amazing. Your cut in on here is Steve Biko. But before we get into that, I want to talk about this album cover, because I remember when this dropped, it was so amazing, like having like pretty much everyone you listen to on the cover. Mm-hmm. Like you got the Beastie Boys, you got Stiv, you got the Far Side, you got, you know, Diamond D, you got like everybody who was like relevant in hip hop, Third Base. It's all here, but there's one weird person here. Do you know who that is?
Puff Daddy.
Is that Diddy?
Puff Daddy. Yes.
That's like Diddy.
That is Puff Daddy. And what's crazy?
Oh my God, it's amazing.
I never knew that.
Yeah, and I didn't know it either until I saw like some article on Ambrosia for Heads. It just site just shut down. Rest in peace, Ambrosia for Heads. But yeah, like basically he essentially was kind of like right place, right time. It was like before he had a record, before anything, and he was hanging out with I think Chris Lighty, and they said come along and you know.
Didn't Puff have something to do with Heavy D, like pre-Bad Boy?
Uptown.
I could be wrong on this.
Yeah, Uptown. When he was at Uptown Records.
Sure. And, yeah, right. There we go.
Right. Heavy D was kind of hot then. He did some shows with him down in D.C. also.
Gotcha. Yeah. So I could see that being like a on the, you know, the degrees of separation that
could
connect.
Small, yeah, exactly. You know, definitely.
Totally. And Hev's on that cover too. Hello. Can you guys hear the record or no?
Yeah.
Yep.
Okay.
Yeah. I never even thought about that, and you're so right that like having all those the faces on the cover, it was like it gave you a reference point before you even put the record on, which is like until we're having this conversation, I never realized that was like a really fucking cool component of it.
It's kind of like when you're record shopping and you see the Def Jam logo, you're like, okay, I already know what this sounds like, or the Jive logo. Now you had every face on it, so you knew where they were coming from.
Yeah, I remember it being a game. You'd be like, okay, I know that. Okay, who's the? You know what I mean?
Right,
trying to figure
out
who the faces were.
Yeah, it had to be like the ultimate like validation to be on that cover.
Yep.
That time period. I mean, I think it also validated what we were listening to, like. You know, Souls of Mischief and Farside weren't getting a lot of love on the East Coast, but to see them on an East Coast album cover like that was just like, oh, okay, like...
Yeah, it was unifying.
Yeah. So tell us about Steve Biko. Stir it up.
This is one of the few, you know, I when I gave you the list, I really didn't think about it very much. I was just kind of like, because obviously you could do this. I mean, the true list would probably be in the hundreds, if not thousands.
Sure.
But, you know, I was just kind of like picking things that popped into my head as it went, and like that tune popped into my head, and it was funny because after I put it on the list, I was like, why did I put that on the list? And then I realized this is one of the few songs that, like, I don't know if this is gonna make sense to you guys, but like music for me is a thing that, like, if I listen to a record over a period of several years, my relationship to that record just becomes this constantly evolving thing. So there's no nostalgia, there's no like, oh, this is a thing that I can put myself in a particular place in time, and like it's time stamped in my mind, if that makes any sense. most music is not time stamped in my mind because I'm usually extracting more things out of it. Like Weather Report's a perfect example of something. Like every time I listen to it, I kind of hear something else. Mm-hmm. This is one of the few songs that, like, I will just never forget the experience of putting this record on and having the experience of listening to this song and being like, something about the feel of it. It was like, it might sound corny, but it's like, it felt like almost comforting or like home. Like the mm-hmm. It's the vibe of the loop. The loop is so fucking dope, man. It's like Q-Tip's loop selection is just like unparalleled, man. And it just has a feel that's like, for me, it was like, I feel like I'm gonna love this fucking album.
Right. And it's the first song on the album, so it immediately gets you. Mm-hmm. And then what's it going to award tour right after that? I think so.
Yeah.
And then I mean, like, you're just hooked. You're like immediately, like, you're open to the album. I mean, you know, and obviously coming off of Low End Theory. I mean, Low End Theory already had established them as like, okay, this is like one of the greatest hip hop groups ever. But then they did this, and it was like, okay, now these guys are just
It solidified. It was like, boom, this is you know.
So going back to what you're saying about listening to the album, would you say that's more of a, it seems like you're listening to it from more of a producer point of view. Like, you still had a few nostalgic points, but like your ear and the way you're listening to is more from a producer point of view. Would you say that?
For this album?
No, the song, when you heard the song. You said
no, it's
every
actually,
time
it's
you hear the song, or every time you hear the song on the album, it seems to just get, like, you absorb more and more and more of it. Is it because of the producer ear that's saying?
Yeah. Right. So, like, award tour is a perfect example of something that, like, when I hear it, I can't help but pick apart the components of the song. Right. Most of the songs on this record, it just, especially like being a break guy, it was just like, you habituate your ear to that, and it's really, really hard to turn it off.
Right.
But so Steve Biko is one of the few songs where that I can also just feel like I just listen to it is a holistic piece of music. It's just a fucking song. And right. I don't care what the drums are. Like, I can't say that about much rap music. Right. There's probably four rap songs in the history where I can say, I don't care about what the drums are and sound like or used.
Right.
And that's one of them. You know what I mean? Because just the mood of the song is just like, it just feels like summer to me. It just feels, and the lyrics are like, it's not like super heady. They come into the track, there's no drums, it's just the loop. You know, it's five. It's just dope, man.
Yeah.
All right, there it is. Tribe Called Quest, Steve Biko, Stirred Up. All right, keeping with hip hop from the same era, we got Organized Confusion, Stress. Such a good one. And, who picked this? Apathy picked this when we had him on the show.
Really?
But yeah, so tell me about Organized Confusion, another Queens banger, 1994, 1 year after Steve Biko.
I honestly think that this might be the most unheralded, like, if there is a rap record in history that didn't get its propers, mm-hmm. to me, it might be this record. Like, I can still listen to this record.
Yeah.
Front to back, and every second of this record is fucking amazing. I will easily put it over certain things in like the Woo mm-hmm. catalog or the Native Tongues catalog. That's no disrespect. I love those acts,
sure.
But I'm saying, like, I literally think this album, as far as the rap records go, it's about as perfect as you can fucking get. As far as
yeah.
I don't know, man. I mean, some of these are really hard to like.
To kind of put the word down.
But I will say that, like, the rhythm of both of them, in particular Pharaoh, mm-hmm. but I mean, they were both like right there in terms of just their command of rhythm mm-hmm. was so precise. It really is.
Yeah.
The only thing that I can relate it to is like when I listen to Pharaoh rap and where he places his syllables over a beat. I get the same feeling when I listen to Thelonious Monk and where he places notes over a bar. And there's really, it's just two different incarnations of, like, maybe not the same concept or idea, but like very, very, very similar, if that makes sense.
Yeah, I mean, it's like, you think about like Bring It On, he's like, and he's really like playing with like pronunciation and like cadence and like how you even say a word to make it like poetically fit. It's just...
And everything has intent. It's like if he's landing on the beat, it just, that's the best way I can put it, is it feels like every syllable has intent. Like when he wants to land on the beat, he's right on top of the beat. If he's dragging behind the beat, it's very conscious. He's not like, this isn't a habit. Like there's rappers that like, they, you know, I won't name them, but like they'll follow in a habit of rapping behind the beat, and it just becomes a thing that they do, and I don't think they're really even thinking about it. With Pharaoh, it feels like he's constantly aware of like precisely where his rhythms are falling. It's musically, if you didn't understand English, I think it's completely fascinating from music.
right.
Seriously.
I think what you said about the song and the track also applies to the group. I always thought this was one of the most unrepresented, unheralded groups around. I remember when they first came out, I remember listening to a tape with Rock Barry and Hollywood Basic. I was in the back of his car and he said, I got this group coming out. And he put it in and I was just like, who is this? And you know, like they were just so far ahead of their time.
Oh
like,
yeah, releasing so Hypnotical Gases was fucking crazy. Yeah.
Good.
Yeah, and you're like, what the?
Yeah, a completely classic record. It's interesting, you said it's a record that never really drops, but I'm curious if you've heard the French Montana Pharrell usage of it with Bring Them Things.
Usage of what? No, I have not.
Of
I'm
this
not.
Beat. Yeah, like, so basically there's
Wait,
like
this beat?
Yes, yeah. They made it into like a club banger.
Yeah.
It's actually pretty good.
No like, shit.
I mean, it's good. It's good as a club banger. I mean, they're not touching what Pharaoh did lyrically. I mean, it's you know, you got to turn it down a little bit. You got to be in the club, drinking your hand, and you're into it. But
I never took those things personally as like, because I know a lot of like guys who really take hip hop seriously will like get in their feelings about that kind of shit.
Sure.
And I never really, to me, it was almost kind of like the op. Like, remember when J-Lo used the loop that the Beat Nuts used, but then there was like, it was some shit because like, well, they didn't clear it anyway. So then it was like, what the fuck are you gonna do? Mm-hmm. To me, it was more like, I took it as like J-Lo thinks this beat is dope.
Right.
Not like J-Lo's jacking Beat Nuts. Well, I mean, there's fucking, you know, chocolate and vanilla is completely opposite.
It's a little bit of both, I think. You know what I mean? Because on one hand, you're like, you know, I think especially when you're younger like that, and especially during that era, there was like this, like, hip hop is mine. It's my little secret, and I'm gonna share it with the select few in my group. You know what I mean? And you're like, you know, and so then when you see something go to the J-Lo record, and you're like, you know, hey, you know, you get kind of get that offended.
Yeah. I get it. I just think that there's inevitably, for me, if you aren't growing out of that at some point in your life, then you're kind of, you know, I don't think, I think
you're
stuck. Yeah, you're making yourself blind to parts of, like, you know, the world. Yeah.
Sure. All right, there it is. Organized Confusion, Stress. Cut.
The real hip-hop, MCing, and DJing from your own mind, you know?
I guess right now we should start the show. So,
well played, sir.
Yeah, we have Gangstar.
I probably would have overlooked that joke.
Yeah. Gangstar, you know my steez. Lead single to Moment of Truth. It's a little more recent. I mean, well, it's not recent anymore. It's a long time ago, but it's a little further out than your two earlier picks.
Yeah, and it's a single. I'm sorry, it's not like the deepest of album.
Yeah.
But you know, it was hard for me to pick something off of this album. Really, I picked this song because I was more trying to pick this album.
And this album?
That album. Precisely. Yeah.
Just
that
wanted
album.
To make sure.
This motherfucker.
God damn.
Yeah, this album really, like, you know, people, there's a saying like XYZ changed my life, but like there's not a lot of things that I can say literally changed the trajectory of how I, this album changed my life, and it did because it changed my understanding of music. I can name, you know, maybe 5 or 6 or 7 instances of records that literally changed my life, not because they were like, oh, I really love this record. It was because they shattered a preconceived notion that I had about what could be done with either a music or an album or a career or a sound or an engineering approach, you know. So this album really, to me, like, coming from Daily Operation to Hard to Earn to this album, it was really like, for me, I had never seen a producer updated, like, I mean, they say it literally in that one intro, like, they update, they've got a formula, but then they update it. But it's like the progression of what he did culminating to this, and really even after this, I'm not even bullshitting, like, I have probably 5 or 6 chapters in my mind of a book that could be written about what Premier did between 92 and 2001. Because even the period after this, there's some really significant and interesting things that happened with the selection of drums, mm-hmm. the lack of selection. In the longest time, I was like, I either didn't understand it, or I was like, I was maybe not mad at it, but I didn't get it, and I finally understood it. But this was an album where it was like, you know, Hard to Earn was a record that was really interesting for producer nerds, because it was like, for all intents and purposes, if you can't train spot every single drum break on that record, you're not, it should be obvious for people that do what I do, right. To be blunt. This was an album where he abandoned that. Nobody can effectively identify any of the drums.
Right.
As best I can tell, they're a composite of drum breaks, but also engineering techniques.
Uh-huh.
And he really brought this, like, the melodic chopping thing into fruition in a way that, like, everybody imitated the style. And what I feel like they didn't get is that, like, yeah, he could take a record apart and he could turn it into chops, but when he put it back together, he did it in this way, manner, like, this is, and this beat is, might be the best example of it. It's both melodic and rhythmic.
Mm-hmm.
It's to me, it's to draw an analogy, it's very, very similar to a Jimmy Page riff, in that it's not a chord, and it's not a melody. But if you look at Black Dog by Led Zeppelin, it's like, it's not a chord, and it's not a melody, it's a riff. It's a thing that is this, its significance is half rhythmic and half melodic, and Premier really mastered that concept on this record to me. It's like, we can all, if you know this record, you should be able to basically listen to the beats in your head, and just, they're so fucking melodic, but like, that's the best way I can put it.
Right, okay.
Is that making any sense to you guys?
Yeah, no, it does. I mean, you obviously have a very more, you know, technical perspective, because you're speaking from, you're kind of breaking it down in terms of, you know, how you might approach it, or how, what you see it deconstructed, I guess, you know.
Real quick, please turn it down.
Yeah.
I was going to say, RJ, do you like every type of music you listen to, not just hip hop, do you have a tendency to break down like everything like this?
It's a
if you're in a car and you hear a brand new J-Lo and she hasn't sampled anything obvious, are you like, oh, that's snares from this machine. Oh, it sounds like a bass player there. Oh, it looks like they looped it. Oh,
yeah.
Man, the chorus, they repeated it 4 times. Wow. Like,
yeah.
You know,
yeah. Yeah.
Real verse. Like, do you do that?
Yeah, I do. And I went to music. I'm a fucking nerd.
Yeah.
Which you're getting driving at. Yes, my friend, I'm a fucking nerd.
Yeah, we can move on.
And if you need my bona fides, I'll prove it like this. I went to a music school before I got into hip hop. And then when I went to college, I was my major was fucking mathematics, because I like to solve problems. Like I enjoyed calculus, if you want to know how fucking weird. So anyway, yeah, I do that. And that's why songs like Steve Biko are like, to me, valuable, because it's few and far between where I hear a song and I can just absorb myself in the emotion and the feeling of the record without thinking about it at all. It happens very rarely for me. So, yeah, with like a if I hear a J-Lo, I mean, it's bad. Like, I mean, yeah, I wouldn't say bad. It used to be bad. There's a period of about 3 to 4 years where I basically hated listening to music because I couldn't turn it off and I didn't know how to just let that
enjoy it
and basically let that code run in the background.
Yeah.
So from about 2006 to 2009, I really didn't like listening to music. It was a fucking dark period. But I finally came out of that where I could now like have that code run in the background when I listen to a song, but still enjoy it basically.
Right.
But yeah, I will basically like transcribe songs in my head as I'm hearing them as far as like harmonically what's happening. And that's why I really, really gravitate toward now music that I can't easily transcribe. Like if you listen to Tom Petty songs, they're like, I can place basically the chord structure and where the melodies are falling in relation to each chord as I'm going because they're relatively simple.
Right.
That's no slam. I'm not being a dick. I'm just stating a fact. So when I listen to things like a Thundercat record, I gravitate to that because the chord structure in the songs isn't immediately recognizable. But if I can kind of let that just live in the background and enjoy the mood.
Yeah.
Now I'm in a place where I'm like really excited about the song, but sadly, it's hard for me to get excited about shit that's hyper, hyper, hyper simple.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Let me ask you about this: the Three Men and a Lady remix of You Know My Steez. Are you familiar with that? With the Corrupt and
I remember that 12-inch coming out. I haven't seen that fucking cover in at least 10 years.
It's pretty good. It's pretty good. I mean, everyone's kind of actually Guru steps his rap game up, like to compete with Rage and Corrupt. It's pretty dope.
Yeah.
So you should go check that one out on the internet.
Another 12-inch I slept on, man. Sadly.
Yeah.
You're making me jealous here, Mike. Are you just trying to pop your collar or something?
It's man. It's let the record show, baby.
Apparently so, man. Damn.
All right, there it is, Gangstar. You Know My Steez. John Coltrane, Giant Steps. So this is kind of cool. This is a gift to me. This is a record I've had for a minute that S Boogie wrote. Pizzo, I hope you hear what he's saying. Peace and respect, S Boogie. 2/28/01. That was my birthday in the year 2001.
You got that for your birthday in 2001.
Yeah, yeah. S Boogie. Great. Shout out S Boogie. So, Giant Steps. Giant Steps is your cut. Tell us about this.
I would say that for me, I think this is the most significant chord change that was written in the 20th century.
Mm-hmm.
This is one of those songs that, like, this kind of music, when I was first introduced to it, was so far ahead of what I could understand that I was forced to just appreciate it on its aesthetic merits. And that's what I did for many years. At a point after I started, you know, realizing that I really couldn't just make records using samples forever, and I had to like buckle down and really be able to, you know, play something.
Mm-hmm.
That eventually led to a place of figuring out, taking my favorite songs and pulling them apart and at least understanding, I might not be able to play them. I mean, playing this song at this tempo is a fucking suicide mission. It's insane. But just to understand it, once you understand it, it's the best way I can put it is it's the most beautiful, like, self-resolving math equation that's existed in a piece of music that I'm aware of, and that's no hyperbole.
What you said about the chord changes, I mean, these literally became known as Coltrane changes, like he essentially defined a sound or a style, but what you're saying on the mathematical side is essentially how many notes or beats he's kind of cramming into the rhythm itself, or
the best way I can describe it is the basically the root or the tonic of the chord structure shifts every half bar, it would be really boring for me to break down what the chord change actually is. Mm-hmm. But here's the best way I can describe it, is like, if you listen to blues music and somebody's like chugging along in like F sharp minor and they're gonna play a blues change, let's say they're gonna play a 1-4-5 blues change. If you were to take a scale, you could take a pentatonic blues scale in F sharp, and it's not gonna matter where any of those notes and any of those chords land, because every single note in a F sharp minor blues scale, regardless of what note you select in any given moment, it's going to work over whether it's the one chord, the four chord, or the five chord. It doesn't matter, okay?
Mm-hmm.
So that, by and large, blues music will just chug along in F sharp minor for 3.5 minutes.
Right.
You imagine a scenario in which a blues chord change were to throw in something like a major sixth chord somewhere within that structure. Now, wherever that major sixth chord is going to land, that F sharp minor blues scale, if you're soloing in it, it's not going to work. It's going to sound like shit. It's going to clash. John Coltrane wrote a piece of music that shifts every half bar.
Wow.
There's an anecdote that says that McCoy Tyner was like, I'm paraphrasing, but basically when Coltrane showed him the piece of music and then he counted it off,
mm-hmm.
that he said something to the effect of like, this is a suicide mission. Like, this is inhuman. Nobody can do this.
Right.
And it's true. Like, once you learn just to play the chord change at half this speed is really, really hard.
Yeah.
The fact that they can play this music and he can improvise,
right,
and his mind can shift every half bar, that it's
wild. It's
inhuman. It's like the best thing I can draw as an analogy is, you know that movie Free Solo?
Yeah
this is a feat that like no human will probably ever achieve again.
Amazing. How about, so one of the other records you picked, which we didn't get here in time, was Chaka Khan, What You Gonna Do For Me. But have you heard the Chaka Khan bebop medley where she kind of like does a little cover of this?
Yeah.
What were your thoughts on that?
It's on record. I can't remember. It's cool. You know, I have a knee-jerk reaction to like, to scatting, uh-huh. like, or to like jazz singing. I got right. I really, it's, I gotta, put arm blank, bro. Like, that's like, okay, cool over there, but over here we're doing this other thing. And
right.
That, you know what I mean?
Right.
It's cool. I mean, it's Chaka Khan. That's like, right. I'm not, what are you not, if you, if what you're driving here is you're trying to get me on record saying something bad as shit. About
no,
Chaka Khan.
Come on. I was just asking your opinion. No, in fact,
I know you're not. I know you're, I'm
yeah.
No, it's my opinion. It's okay. It's,
yeah.
I liked it. What I took it as is like a nod to what she likes.
Mm-hmm.
R&B singers have done this before with this. Like, I take it as a nod. It's like, okay, she likes this. And it's mm-hmm. obvious that, you know, there's a lot of, her catalog is littered with jazz influence, of course,
right.
With Arif Mardin and all that. So is it my favorite shit in her repertoire? No, it's fine. It doesn't make me angry. And I think it's cool. It's there's like, but it's hard. This is one of the few songs where it's like, I mean, I've heard amazing people cover this,
right?
Like in jazz combos and stuff,
right?
And even then, it's like they'll admit it's like, oh, we're just,
trying.
Yeah, exactly. We're right. Yeah, we're desperately grasping.
Right.
Fucking God.
Like, let's see if we can, but we probably can't, right?
Exactly. Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. All right. There it is. John Coltrane. Giant Steps. All right, next up, we got Weather Report, Black Market LP, and your cut is Black Market on here.
This is
a product.
Although the whole album is a masterpiece to me.
Yeah, there's one really familiar sample on here I want to talk about in a minute.
Sure, yeah.
But yeah, this is a Wayne Shorter, product of Wayne Shorter, who played with Miles and Art Blakey and them. And yeah, tell us about this. I mean, I don't know a lot about this record, so
give us some education here.
This is, to me, this is my favorite jazz ensemble. You know, to use like a rap analogy, you could maybe call it like, geez, I don't even know. I mean, Quest may be an example, but like every single person that was on any of these records was extremely highly functioning. Mm-hmm. And Jaco Pastorius was the bass player on most of these records. Mm-hmm. And in his own right, he wrote some amazing stuff. Zawinul, the keyboard player, he wrote a lot of the Cannonball stuff. He played with Miles. Mm-hmm. He had a very long standing pedigree. Wayne Shorter, obviously his pedigree runs super deep. So in my mind, this is really like the primary jazz supergroup, if you will.
Sure.
And coming back to that feel of like that I get from Steve Biko, this is one of the few, and there's their catalog is littered with these moments, but moments where I can just, for whatever reason, I don't even understand why, my mind, the analytical mind, can just turn off and I can just be in the moment and just appreciate the aesthetic, the pure feeling that is in the song, which is really rare for me. And this one is, I just love the feel of this. It's so simple, and yet it's so, this is gonna sound like super not eloquent, but it's not boring to me.
Right.
Like, there's a lot of music that's simple that I find boring, that I don't get anything out of. And their compositions are really, really great at like taking fairly simple ideas and making them just with some very slight harmonic nudges. Until you pick them apart and you learn them, you realize what they're doing, and there's some very, very, very slight changes or I'm not going to get too heady with it, but I just love the way it feels. And then, and another thing that I took from Weather Report is there's a lot of stuff that I like. This, okay? They wrote a lot of linear songs. So their music, like, they'll never return. The piece that this started in, it's gone.
Right.
They're not going to return to that. So they would write songs that were basically A section, B section, C section, songs over.
Yeah.
Done. That's a very rare thing in this type of music.
It's interesting you kind of said about them all, like, you know, being kind of like superheroes in a way that, you know, maybe you didn't make that analogy, but basically everybody being extremely capable and great at their job as whatever instrument they were playing. And one of the points that we were just talking about off camera was when we had Skyzoo on the show, and he was talking about all the jazz that he listens to. And if you remember, Warren, he was making that point that, like, this was like, these guys were like the Wu-Tang Clan.
Yeah.
Like, you would look at the back of the album, like, back then, you might look at the album to see, like, oh, okay, you know, you got Miles here, and you got Coltrane here, and you got Wayne Shorter, and you got, and they were all popping up on each other's records. It's kind of like the way we hip-hop heads look at production credits, essentially.
Right. Totally.
When RJ said that, the thing I kept pulling my head is, oh, this is probably like the Juice Crew of...
right.
That's a great analogy. Yeah, totally.
Wu-Tang Clan,
Yeah.
Everybody's capable. There's not a weak link in the bunch. You know what I mean? Like, it's, and everyone went and did different things, and
they all have their own character to their voice and their style.
Right.
They still sound great if you jam them all onto a song and they're doing their own thing. It still sounds phenomenal.
Right.
And this shit to me is really like, I'm not gonna lie. Like, to me, I get the same feeling of like when I listen to The Meters or something like that. I feel like okay. This is the blueprint of hip-hop, like, and I don't mean just in a sampling sense, I mean it's like in the rhythmic sensibility, in the groove sensibility, the feet, if you could reduce, you know, any of The Meters, like classic Josie recordings, down to a feeling, I have a very similar feeling about some very classic hip-hop, and to Weather Report, exact same, like this groove right here, to me it feels like some, you know, 1990, you know, Cold Chillin' shit to me. Up-tempo funk, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
It's like,
right.
So basically there's a super familiar sample here.
Okay.
That's like on one of the greatest albums of all time. I'm just curious if you can place it. It's right at the beginning of Elegant People. Hold on.
Yeah.
Do you hear it, RJ, or are you able to identify it?
And I'm terrible about this stuff. Like, I'm the kind of guy that's like, I'll recognize a sound, but I don't know where I recognize it from.
All right, so here's what I'm going to do. I'm actually going to play the sample for
everyone. This is great.
Yeah, that's the part. Yeah, that's the part I thought.
Yeah.
I don't know what it is yet, though.
Do you know, RJ?
Yeah. Cut it off. Don't snitch.
Okay. What is it?
I'm not going to snitch, bro.
You're not going to snitch?
I still don't hear it.
It's on the sample.
I know what it is. I'm very much...
Okay, so that's the part I heard. I was like, that sounds familiar, but I couldn't place it.
Crazy. I never even made the connection.
Yeah.
All right, there it is. Go ahead.
RJ, when's the last time that you actually, like... you just ride around in your car or whatever, and you heard a song. You're like, "Oh shit, that's like." When's the last time that happened to you?
Just now.
That I recognize the sound.
Yeah, like just now. Like when's just the last now, time? This moment. Yeah, just before this.
The last and ironically, it's funny you mentioned this because it's a Jaco Pastorius passage. But there was I don't even know what record it is, but it was it must have been like a top 40 hit. I for some reason I'm placing it as a. Like an R&B tune that was somehow Bow Wow related, but there's a in the
wait. Did you say Bow Wow related?
Yeah,
Lil Bow Wow.
Yeah,
okay,
I believe my memory might be foggy here, but there was a really big R&B hit, and it basically used the exact chord change that was A Portrait of Tracy by Jaco Pastorius, which is ironically the bass player in Weather Report. If you guys were to look up that song, it's not a sample. But it's a note for note replay of the chord change, and I remember hearing it on the radio and be like, "Oh, that's a Portrait of Tracy," and it was a really really big hit. I wish I could remember what.
And was it good? How was it? Did they do
it
justice?
Wasn't bad. I think it was like, for some reason in my mind, I'm putting this as like Neo and Bow Wow related. I have no idea if that's right.
Okay. Well, I mean, if you don't know the song and you're saying it's good, but you're saying it's Neo and Bow Wow, like I beg to differ.
Hey, Neo's from Vegas, man.
Bow Wow.
Like, easy on the Neo blasphemy.
I might not ride for Neo, but it's some decent cuts, man.
All right, there it is. Weather Report, Black Market, with a little bit of Portishead Strangers in there.
Nice one, Pizzo.
Jan Hammer Group, and this is a promo copy. You can see right there.
Wow.
Demonstration, not for sale. Yeah. I'm just going to send this to you, RJ, because you were talking about you were getting jealous earlier.
The promo?
Yeah, I'm going to send you the promo.
My copy is a promo, too.
Oh, yeah. Oh, okay.
I have 100 Muslims. Yeah, fuck you, too, bro.
Okay, so. So Don't You Know is a cut, and man, like I only the thing I knew about Jan Hammer was he did the Miami Vice theme, or he or she, I don't know who Jan Hammer is.
Okay. I'm not gonna I don't give a shit about this stuff, but I was at one point in time corrected that his first name is pronounced Jan. If we want to go there, I don't give
No, we should go there because I want to get this right. So Jan, well, how do you say hammer then? Is it like hammer?
When I do it, I go full Eastern Europe with Jan, and then I go full Texas with hammer. You know, but I'm probably not doing it right. So,
You go, his friends go, Jan, don't hurt him.
Jan, don't hurt him.
There you go. Hey,
please, man. Jan. Please.
Please, Jan, don't hurt him.
So, you know what's crazy, man, is, I mean, when I heard this, I was like, okay, I could definitely see the direct relationship in this music to your own music, but even more so was like 07. Like I was like 07 listened to this album and then made their album or Air Moon Safari.
Totally.
I was like, yeah, they listened to this album and then made their album. So
yeah.
So tell us about this. This is incredibly.
So I found my way to this record through. I'm a big the Weather Report. Probably, tells the story of like, I'm a pretty big jazz fusion head.
Yeah,
like,
yeah.
I'm into it. And he played on a lot of records. He played on some of the Mahavishnu Orchestra records. And so I got hip to him because like, there was a lot of cross-pollination in that world between, like, you know, you'd see Chick Corea pop up on other records, and like all the ECM stuff was very like cross-pollinated. And so anyway, he was playing on a lot of records, fusion records, between like, you know, 67 and 75 or whatever, and I found my way to this record. And it really, to me, is kind of like, this album is an anomaly in this, like, you could put this in the jazz section as easily as you could put it in the soul section to me, or the R&B section. I mean, right. It's really no different than, like, it's basically a slow Patrice Rushen record,
yeah,
if you will, that has like more ambitious chord changes.
Yeah,
basically. And the playing is really, really fucking good. But I mean, every single composition, as far as I'm concerned, it's another one that's like, the blueprint of hip hop is in it, Timmy. It's like every single song. I feel like you could just jack, like, if you got stuck on an island with one album and you had to make a hip hop record, this is a decent candidate.
You can just take this one apart.
Yeah, just jack the shit out of every single, you know. So, and this is one great song, but I mean, and it's a weird one too, because it's like, it's just not that well known.
Right. You know?
Real quick, I got a comment on it. So I love the take on, okay, if you were stuck on a desert island and you had to make a hip hop album,
it's you and the SP.
It's like Survivor hip hop. Hip hop producer Survivor.
I mean, so, you've probably met some producers that you wanted to ship to an island with just their fucking NPC and see how they.
Yeah, let's look at the other sample on here.
Okay, there's a few. Yeah, yeah.
All right, we were talking about this. Let's see if anyone here can call it. I think RJ probably be able to call it, but...
See, I'm reticent to train spot it. I don't want to snitch, man. Here it comes. Listen. It's not here.
Oh yeah, that's
Daylight. Yeah.
Alright.
Yep. Doggy dog competition.
Yeah.
Stakes is high album, yep.
Yeah. Beautiful crazy sample. Yep.
And I think you said Dilla used something on here too, right?
I thought there was a point in one of these tunes where I felt I don't want to narc, man.
It's all, honestly, man, like I don't feel so weird about it anymore because it's all out there. I mean,
yeah, I probably shouldn't. Still, you know, we gotta, you know, what do they say? A man's gotta have a code, you know?
Right. Okay, now tell.
All right, there it is. Jan Hammer Group.
Jan Hammer. Jan. Jan,
Jan
Hammer,
Hammer Jan, Group. Jan. There it is. Yeah. There
please,
it is.
Jan, don't hurt him. Don't hurt him, Jan.
So you got mail, RJ.
You got mail. Yeah. Did that just come while we were talking?
Yeah.
Shit, man.
All right, let's hear it. Okay, so as we said, the mail like literally just arrived and the Chaka Khan record came. Shout out Discogs. What you gonna do for me? Damn. Look at that, dude.
Is that really?
This is literally a promo.
There you go. Sale is unlawful.
You want this one? I'll send you this one.
I don't have a promo.
I'm going to send you the promo.
I'll trade you, bro. Let's do it. Right. Gladly. Okay. So I probably owe you some records.
Okay, give us the story, man. What's the deal on this? We talked a little bit earlier about the connection back to Coltrane. And now you can say something good about Chaka Khan.
Oh man, I met Chaka Khan in the Whole Foods out in Wynwood in Philadelphia, and I freaked the fuck out, man.
Really?
I was like, I made a scene, bro. I felt
how
bad.
Long ago?
I don't know, maybe that's like 6 or 7 years. She played this song. They did this like free show in West Philly. It was like 2 blocks from my house where I lived in Philadelphia. And it was like 52nd in Baltimore. And they had Mos Def play once. Random aside, this is no. I'll never forget. They had Robin Thicke play one year, and like he left the show. He came to and left the show in a limo, and like my buddy lived like three houses down from the stage. Because he did it right on the intersection. They'd block off. It was like a block party.
Block party thing.
Yeah, yeah, straight up block party. And my buddy used to live like three houses down from literally the stage. So we were just like kicking on his porch. And like Robin Thicke drives, at the end of the show, Robin Thicke rides by in his limo and he rolls down the window and waves. And like, we couldn't give a fuck less. Like, it was the funniest thing because he was like waving at some people that were like, are you done yet, man?
Right,
like,
right.
We just want to go have.
Was this when he had long hair?
Was this during his long hair bike messenger phase?
You guys don't remember that.
I know.
You remember that? Okay.
I remember with the Fifth of Beethoven riff.
Yep. Yeah.
So anyway, I digress. Chaka Khan played one of those block parties. She played this song, and I was on fucking cloud nine. I don't know. This is just like when you're DJing. This is my shit. This is like the bag I'm in. It's like the groove is great. The bass is hitting. It's not like. And Chaka Khan's just so dope, man. I don't know. Like.
Have you heard the recently released I Feel For You demo by Prince? Yeah.
No.
They just released a 45 of it.
Really?
I don't actually think it came out yet. I saw some pre-order stuff, but basically it was like his original demo.
It's jazz, you know, there's like fucking text. See the modulation there? Where she's going right now with the song is like
in your moment.
I am.
Yeah.
I feel free was dope, but that's a drum machine. And that's like, and what I think is really fascinating about this era of R&B is like the rest of it. Like Patrice Rushen records could do this at times. Like it's so tight and it feels like a quantized groove, but it's not. Like, this is a band.
Right,
like,
right.
Like your ear doesn't interpret this as like I'm listening to Dyke and the Blazers or Incredible Congo Banders. This doesn't feel classic breaking.
Right.
But
this
it
is
also
on time.
It's on time as a motherfucker.
Right. Yeah, yeah.
But it's a band. You're so incredibly tight, and the way they're engineered, your ear kind of translates it like it's sequenced music, even though it's not. And I think it's really interesting to me.
All right, there it is.
It's a good song, man.
Chaka Khan.
All right.
All right, next up we have Metallica, Master of Puppets LP. And man, I got to say, like, these heavy metal covers in the 80s were so dark and negative. Like, here's the hands of God playing with the puppet strings of the dead soldier. I mean, it was always just, like, so dark and it's so disturbing to me. But anyway, what's cool is it says Obey Your Remaster, the number one greatest heavy metal album of all time, according to the Rolling Stone Reader's Poll.
Might be.
Do you think it's the greatest?
Quite possibly.
Okay.
You know, to me, Ride the Lightning, Master of Puppets, and Justice for All were like the three that... I'm probably overstating it by calling it a holy trinity, but it really is like...
That's the trio.
For me, it really is, you know.
So Battery's your cut here, and let me just take a guess here.
Okay.
This is some thrash metal. I mean, is what you see in this the same thing that you see in John Coltrane? The fact that they are essentially like playing the guitar at different rhythms or than might be normal to the untrained ear.
This is probably the only thing on the list that I don't.
I don't have a musical.
I don't know if I can reduce it down to a story or a narrative. I'm being honest. These records, when I was young, I didn't really. It wasn't until I was maybe I think 16 or 17 that I understood this distinction between the cultural distinction between like. There's metal guys and there's hip hop guys and there's goth guys. You know what I mean? I graduated in 94 in high school. That was, you know, in broad strokes, sort of the and there was the jocks, you know, and there's the theater kids. You know what I mean? And I didn't really understand until that period that those distinctions. So I was listening to UTFO and Jazzy Jeff and the Fresh Prince next to Zeppelin, next to Metallica, next to Depeche Mode, to Tears for Fears, so on and so forth. And there was never any, I didn't understand an environment in which there would be any contradiction in that.
Genre. So you didn't understand the genre as a, yeah.
Yeah, gotcha. Yeah, I'm being long-winded and you're being smarter. So this, you know, these records came along and it was just like, I literally don't know if I can reduce it down to, like, if I was stuck on an airplane, I don't know if I could explain to an accountant why this is good.
Right.
It's very fucking good to me.
Yeah.
It's good to not have genres, or this record's good?
This record's good. Oh, this record, yeah. Those three Metallica records were on, and I can't say that I'm like a dyed-in-the-wool, like, thrash metal fan.
Right.
It's not that I'm like, I ascribe to this genre.
Right.
There's something about these three records, and there's a small handful of others. Like, you know, Sepultura made some records that I really like. I don't necessarily like this genre. I just think these records are really special, and I don't entirely know why.
That's really interesting. Yeah.
There's something unlike, I will bet my life on this. There's something unlike these three records of this genre. If that makes sense. So I don't see them as, it's obvious what type of music you would classify them as, but there's some component in them that I couldn't get out of most of the music of this ilk.
That's just what we in the business call a commercially successful record. I mean, think about it. Like, you know, there's people that are not hip hop heads, right? But they love Snoop Dogg. I mean, they have Doggy Style, and they love Doggy Style.
They don't like hip hop.
And they don't like hip hop. I'm not into hip hop. Oh, what kind of music do you listen to? Oh, I like everything, and I love Snoop Dogg.
I like that picture.
Right. That's exactly what you're saying right here. So yeah. It's like when you talk about, like, you know, this is a pinnacle of a heavy metal record. This is it right here. You know what I mean? Like, Daft Punk Discovery is like the pinnacle of a house music album. There's not even a lot of house music albums to point to. You know what I mean? And there's a ton of people that love Daft Punk but do not listen to house music. You know what I mean?
Right. Fair enough. To what I'm going to provide as my counter-argument is this.
Okay.
I've listened to a good amount of thrash metal, and I've listened to a decent amount of, I've heard and been exposed to a pretty good amount of house music.
Right.
So it's not just exposure for me. Like, discovery is such a big deal to me. Not because it's the only house music that I've ever exposed to.
I know.
It's because it's the first music of that type that I was exposed to that really kind of hit home.
Right.
I listened to, I had friends that were like really into thrash metal.
Right.
In middle school. So
yeah,
I was exposed to a lot of that type of music. And most of it didn't, I don't listen to it. I'm not, you know. But this is one where I can put this record on and it's just, you know.
Yeah, and you're different than the average bear. I mean, like, you're a music head. You know what I mean? I'm talking about more like the mainstream person that is like, doesn't, you know what I mean? Is like, doesn't follow hip hop, but loves Snoop Dogg, or, you know, they love Drake, but like, you ask them about Show and AGA, they have no idea what you're talking about.
Yeah. Like, why would I care?
You know? Yeah, they don't even know Wu-Tang. They couldn't name a single member of Wu-Tang Clan, but can sing every Drake song. You know what I mean? Like
right.
You know, so, all right, fair enough. We have Metallica, Battery. Okay, yeah. So the 45 is we're getting towards the end here. So all right. So this is the Impression 7 years. That's your cut.
Oh yeah.
All right. Tell us about this. This just arrived in the mail like literally 5 minutes ago. So this reminds me of early RJ when you were doing a lot more sampling and a lot more breaks and you were very flagrant and didn't really give a shit about, you know.
I could afford
it. Yeah. 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 So.
Yeah, I don't, you know. Do you guys ever have songs? I gotta ask you this. Mm-hmm. Do you have songs where, like, for whatever reason, they come on and, like, you have to fight back tears,
dude.
It's so good.
I'm gonna blow your mind.
Okay, go for it.
Here's What's Left. here's what's left. Dude, here's what's left. Dude, here's what's left is like so like good, and it's like depressing but like bittersweet. Like I was like, dude, this is and yeah, like that made me like a fan of you, like early on. Like I was like, dude, this is yeah, and that's what led to this. That's led to me calling you to do this, to press this. So this is so some context here. This is RJD2 Rain back with what was the B side? Find You Out.
Yeah.
And we pressed this back at Hip Hop Site. But basically, when I heard Here's What's Left, I was like, I gotta find whoever this dude is. Like somehow got your number through like someone at Def Jux or something, or Mighty My or someone, and then this came along. So
nice.
Not to derail this whole conversation, tell us how this record makes you feel, because
it's now my turn to blow your mind.
Okay.
I was gonna give some bullshit explanation about why I like the song. You more perfectly encapsulated what the song means to me than I could have in your words. You said it's this like mix of melancholy and might have said like joy or exuberance.
Mm-hmm.
Like, and that what is this? That song to me is that it's this. And you, if you sit with the lyrics, they're pretty heavy. You know, it's like basically somebody ruminating on effectively wasting their time on Earth. It's really really sad, but the music is so, you know, joyful and exuberant. You put it better than I could have. Really.
Yeah, it's bittersweet. Bittersweet.
Yes, exactly.
It tastes great, but it's so depressing
when it
sinks
in a way. It'll fucking destroy you.
Yeah. Yeah.
But I mean, there's something about like, I don't know. I mean, the impressions might be my, you know, if I were thinking about like vocal soul music, they're probably my favorite group. And there's something about what Cutis Mayfield was able to channel into music that's like, I don't know.
It's brilliant.
It's shockingly good.
Yeah. Yeah. All right. We hit a chord.
Yeah, man.
That's
feelings, bro. You got me there.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, you also have a beer in your hand, so could be.
That too.
It could be that too.
I think it's 14%.
Yeah. All right. Impressions. 7 years. All right, so now we're starting to wrap up, and we're going to talk about your new album, The Fun Ones. Do you have a copy of that nearby?
I sure do.
Ready? You do? Well, look at that.
Nice.
Yeah, and right here I have the 45 for No Helmet up in Indianola, which is the, I probably butchered the pronunciation of that, but this is your first single.
Yes.
What'd you do, 500 of these?
1,000. Okay. 100 clear. And I saw your name, you know, on the shipping. I made sure you got a clear one. So.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
I mean, we go way back, man.
Yeah, yeah, we go way back. So, I mean, you've had an incredible journey here. I mean, it's a long journey. Not to keep going back to old stuff, but I mean, here's the first part of the journey that's captured here. In the RJD2 2002 to 2010 box set, which has your first, what is it, 3 or 4 albums in here?
Yep. Yeah.
Yeah. And now, you know, you've kind of, like we were talking earlier, you were heavy on samples back then, but nowadays you're a little more instrument-based, synth-based, as we can see behind you.
Yeah, and tell
there's
people.
There's a lot going on there.
Off camera, we were talking about how, like, this is the third floor of your house, and, like, all the other rooms have, like, you know, this is only the synth room. Like, there's other rooms with a bunch of other stuff in it, right?
Yeah. This is the synth room. Next to me is the live room, so all the drums, bass amps, percussion stuff, vibraphones, anything that's going to get a microphone put on it is in there. And then down on the basement floor is my record room with the MPC. So I'll kind of like move up and down floors. You know, I'll if I need to, you know, I can basically build the MPC program down in the basement in the record room, bring it up here. I've got an MPC up here, load it up, jump it into Pro Tools, So it's all laid out so that I can have as many tools at my disposal. Nice. At any moment.
It's like a full-time studio in different rooms, it sounds like.
That's what I'm trying, yeah.
Yeah, yeah. Nice. So tell us about the fun ones and like how that studio setup, like, you know, has changed your approach to making music versus how you might have done it back in that, you know, 2002 to 2010 era.
Yeah, you know, it's if I were to go back to 2002 and 2010 and look at this song through that lens, this would have been seen through the lens of like, where do I find the horn sample? Where do I find mm-hmm. the drum break? Mm-hmm. And then, you know, what am I going to do about the keyboard parts? And what about the turnarounds? Like a section like this, I would have had to look for a different record for the root of what would be kind of like right. the C section of the song right. or whatever. So in many ways, I would say that this record is it's the culmination of all of the ideas that I might have executed through samples at a previous time, but done, you know, in a live setting. So I would say, like, is a, you know, if I put myself in the position of, you know, 2002 me, and I was like, I got to find a dope drum break.
Right.
That guy 20 years ago, his highest aspiration would have been to play a drum break, be able to record a drum break that would work, quote unquote, in the context of a recording. So this record is really the end result of many, many years of aspiring to be able to do that in a manner that wasn't through samples.
This might seem like an obvious question or a stupid question, but do you play all those instruments? The drums, the bass, the guitar, everything?
Yeah, everything except the horns. So I would play the drums and drums, bass, guitar, keys, percussion and stuff. I would play this as a drum break. This is a sample drum break. And then the horn line, I would play on a MIDI keyboard. I'd write the line, and then I have I have horn guys that I will go to and be like, can you play this? Basically, I transcribe the MIDI performance into a chart, and then I'd book a horn guy to come in and perform it, and then end up with an entirely live performance.
You know, I want to bring up a funny story I don't think I've ever told you. So back when we were at Hip Hop Site, and, you know, we sold a lot of Dead Ringer, and Since We Last Spoke was about to come out, you know, and so I think we placed a huge order with Caroline, which was a distribution company for people that don't know. And there was another distributor, and I can't remember their name, but they were in like Southern California somewhere. And I think we sold through like our initial batch of pre-orders, and we needed more. And there was this rep that I had over there named Sean, and the guy was like a tried and true metalhead. Didn't know hip hop, like didn't know like anything about what we were doing, but he was my rep. So like I had a good rapport with him. So call him up and I'm like, hey, I need like, you know, 400 more of, Since We Last Spoke, because, you know, we sold through our Caroline pre-order. They were on the West Coast and they were going to get them to me in one day. Right. So I order them and I was like, you got to listen to this record. It's fantastic. You know? And he's like, oh yeah, bro. Yeah, man. Yeah. You know? So the next day, he calls me up and he's like, bro, he's like, I listened to that RJD2 record, man. He's like, man, that guy's playing like every instrument in the world. I mean, he's like so talented, man. And I was like, yeah. And I didn't have the heart to tell him like it was all samples. It's just ironic because now he are, and like you play every instrument in the world, pretty much, you know. So.
That's pretty hilarious.
Yeah, it's a good story to share.
You're just trying to get off the phone as soon as possible. You're like,
yeah. Right, yeah. So,
Sean, what's that tracking number, Sean? Okay, thank you.
Yeah, exactly. So, shout out to Sean. But yeah, so what else you want to tell us about the fun ones before we wrap up here?
Man, it's out now.
You got some guests on?
Yeah, I got some guests. Homeboy Sandman, AC Alone, STS, Jordan Brown, Kari Mateen. It was put together like a mixtape. So this is a fun record to make in that, like, so if you get the vinyl, and this is actually a story I haven't heard. If you get the vinyl version of this, you are getting the the raw material, if you will, it's the songs. The way that this record was recorded was I cut all the tunes and then I did a bunch of conversations with some associates and friends and stuff, and used those as sample fodder to like basically scratch in interludes to make it feel like a mixtape. So the digital version, mixtape, and the but the vinyl version, I intentionally wanted it to be unmixtaped, if you will.
Ah, okay.
If you were to DJ, you can make your own version of the that concept. You know, I wanted the songs themselves to exist without them.
Right.
So it's kind of like a bonus thing. And
Yeah, it's interesting. I wanted to ask you about that. Like, who were the people that you were cutting those little interview snippets up? I mean, and the purpose behind it, I mean, it seemed like you wanted to make some kind of statement. It just rather than the record be straight instrumental record, but you were trying to maybe put some meaning behind the music, but maybe give us a little context there.
Yeah. Fonte Coleman, J-Zone, Kit Koala, Mr. Liff, Blueprint does some, it's a basically his podcast gets utilized on, and it's kind of like a background, you know, sound effect type of thing. And when I realized that I was going to try to do a series of, you know, conversations with people and use them as for this purpose, I realized why not, you know, kind of like streamline the concepts that I was talking, instead of just opening the floor. I realized all the people I'm talking to are between maybe 35 and 45 in a similar station in life as I am, in that they are independent musicians, businessmen, so on and so forth. And I thought, why not have them ask them basically why they're still making records? You know, because at a point in time, for me, I had to, it was natural to start thinking about this, the sense of purpose that was around this,
about
making a record, not just, you know, feeding a family type of thing.
Mm-hmm.
So that sort of, that became the theme as I was speaking to these guys and
yeah, so I guess that leads to the next question. Like, you know, the landscape has changed tremendously since the days of Hip Hop Site, where we were moving physical units and streaming. And you know, I've interviewed you before about licensing your music. I think we did that piece on Q-Point, and maybe in 2015, 2016. But you know, what is the sense of purpose for you personally at this point in your career?
You know, I realized that beyond it being my job, frankly, it's the best way that I think I can be of service to people and humanity with my time on Earth is through music.
And, yeah.
So I can reach the most amount of people, and I think, frankly, provide the most utility to people through making records and putting them out. You know, this record happening right in the middle of like the COVID-19 pandemic is sort of a perfect example, where a lot of artists were saying, decided to pull their records and are waiting until the fall so that they can tour properly and do the thing that they're familiar with. And it didn't even dawn on me, you know, for me, from my point of view, it's like as soon as the record was completed, I wanted to get it into the pipeline as soon as possible because I frankly feel like I am in a race. You know, all of our time on Earth is limited, and I am in a race to put as much music out into the world while I'm here as I possibly can.
Mm.
Because I feel like the leverage of all the things that I have at my disposal, my leverage in music is higher than any other place that I could devote my time to.
Right.
Does that make sense?
Yeah, I mean, I think you're, and I think, look, I think there's a tremendous amount of value in what you have provided. And, you know, I think that creators in general, you start to kind of wonder, like, does anybody read this shit? Does anybody listen to this shit? Does anybody listen to this podcast? Does anybody watch this show? Does anybody read that article? Did anybody listen to my mixtape? Did anyone listen to my album? Do people give a shit about this? And the truth of it is that they do. On all fronts, you know what I mean? And so what you're contributing is very valuable. And as a listener, thank you.
Thank you, man. I appreciate it.
Definitely.
Yeah.
And in a true parent fashion, my son is screaming my name right now.
Yeah. All right, let's wrap it up.
Where the fuck I am.
All right, that is it. This is Let the Record Show. I am Mike Pizzo.
I'm Warren Peace.
And today's special guest,
RJD2. Thanks for having me, guys.
Great to reunite with you. It's been some time, and everyone go get the Fun Ones album. It's out now, and we're out. Peace.
See you guys. Peace.
Late.
All right. Peace.
All the indie rap, none of the crime. It sure does feel good being one of a kind. Come on. All the mountaintops, none of the climb. It sure feels good being one of a kind.